Ajay, thanks so much for being with us at NDTV Profit. Today we've got the all-important FOMC meet and the rate decision, with the expectation being of a 25 basis rate hike from the US Fed coming through. How would you then reassess your portfolio? Anything that you look to add?
Yeah. Good morning and thank you for having me on NDTV Profit. I think there are near-term headwinds that the Indian markets will have to negotiate. There are three or four issues I would like to highlight. The first is, although a 25 basis point rate increase by the US Fed tonight has been factored in, what is important is to focus on the accompanying commentary by the US Fed chairperson. With the announcement of strong reflationary policies by the President-elect Donald Trump, especially, you know, $550 billion of infrastructure buildup, the expectation among many circles is that the Fed has been too dovish, behind the curve, and will have to start raising rates aggressively as we move into the second half of the next calendar year. Now, this sort of, you know, if that were to happen, then that could put a further pressure on yields in US markets. Consequently, the differential of yields between emerging markets and the US could trigger a further risk off trade and outflows from emerging markets. Secondly, domestically, I think this winter session has been almost a washout. People were expecting that the three crucial economic legislations on GST should have been cleared if the rollout was to happen on 1st of April. Now, it does look like it will not be cleared in this session, and hence the budget session is what we'll have to look forward to, provided the state governments and the central government reach a rapprochement. With the compact between the OPEC and non-OPEC members holding firm, I think that sort of, you know, again needs to be closely watched, because every $1 increase in global crude prices means $1 billion of increased import bill for the country, as well as an incremental pressure on the fiscal deficit because of LPG and kerosene subsidies. Also, the demonetization has clearly pushed back the much expected improvement in aggregate demand led by the consumption sector, at least by three months, if not 6 months. So the December results clearly have to be closely watched. But I think the markets will have to temper their expectations of earnings growth for FY17. Today, I think they stand at lofty 17% to 18%. And one will have to wait what kind of earnings growth is posted in December and to take a call on the full year's earnings growth. But it's reasonable to say that there has to be a moderation in that lofty figure of 17 to 18%. So I think these are the near-term headwinds that the markets will have to navigate. And hence, I feel that it would pay to be cautious in the market rather than sort of, you know, being adventurous and sort of, you know, being too gung-ho.
Right. So what would you look to add, Ajay, for your portfolio?
Yeah. See, I think it's very tough to envisage a portfolio construct with large allocations to investment-led themes, because private capex is still quite moribund. The government is making an effort to revive to pump prime the economy through investments in roads, railways, power transmission. But I think the focus, although because of demonetization, consumption-led growth has gotten pushed back, the large allocations still will have to be on some of the consumption themes. Attractive valuations. I think sectors like BFSI, and there again sort of, you know, the NBFCs, I think, which have had a very lofty run before the derating that we saw, I think it will remain for some time. Whereas the retail-based bank franchises are the ones that we prefer. IndusInd Bank and HDFC Bank are our preferred picks out there. And Yes Bank, I think, which has been able to manage its asset quality quite pristinely, despite sort of, you know, being corporate focused bank, would remain in our radar. Also, among NBFCs, I think if sort of, you know, the corrections are steeper, then L&T Finance and Capital First at, say, levels of around 80 and below for L&T Finance and around 510 to 520 levels for Capital First, I think are the ones that we could look at. The other fact that I will still be positive on is the automobiles. I think two-wheelers, we are not so positive. We believe that business will get impacted significantly because of the large rural demand that underpins the demand for motorcycles. Whereas the passenger vehicles business, I think it is relatively unscathed. Our interactions with auto ancillary suppliers also indicate that insofar as the schedules for Maruti are concerned and Hyundai are concerned, I think, you know, they are more or less intact because of large 2 or 3 months of orders pending for models like Creta for Hyundai or for Baleno and Brezza in case of Maruti. So I think as the new currency comes into circulation, hopefully over the next couple of months, they will get enough breather for that 2 or 3 months of waiting list to get exhausted, and new orders could possibly start coming in after that. If it doesn't happen in 2 or 3 months' time, then I think we'll have to also relook at some of the passenger vehicle names. Tata Motors is another franchise we like a lot. 80% of business comes from outside India. A falling British pound spells good news for the company. And I think the parent also has expressed, given a signal about the fact that the franchise is undervalued by buying 2500 crores worth of stock yesterday. So Maruti Suzuki and Tata Motors would remain our top picks in auto ancillary sector. The third sector I would like to focus on is pharmaceuticals. Now here, I think it is the mid-cap franchises that one should look at. And there, I think three names come to mind, Glenmark Pharmaceuticals, Jubilant Life Sciences, and Aurobindo Pharma. In case of Glenmark, just yesterday, on 12th rather, they launched Zetia, which is a $2.6 billion drug. There's annual sales for the drug in the US market for the year ended September 30th. And Par Pharma, along with Glenmark, Glenmark has launched the drug along with Par Pharma, and we are expecting at least a $150 to $160 million of bottom line over a six-month period in the exclusivity period for Glenmark, which they should be using to right-size the balance sheet, repay the debt, and the stock, in our view, is prime for a re-rating. The company also has said that they want to have an analyst meet where all the new chemical entities that they have worked on, they will be speaking about them. I think that meeting is slated in a week or so. Jubilant Life Sciences, and its emphasis on radiology domain is what we like. And there again, sort of, you know, in the medium term, we would advocate investors to look at on dips. The third franchise we like in pharma is Aurobindo Pharma. The stock has been weakish over the last few sessions. But I think this is opportunity for long-term investors to get into the stock.
Right. What do you do with NBFCs? You mentioned a couple of NBFCs in the answers, but with the sort of slowdown, with the sort of asset quality issues that some of these NBFCs may have, do you think that Q3, Q4 numbers may be weak, but that should be a buying opportunity?
Yeah, I think, you know, I would be very cautious in NBFCs. All of them have had moved up very strongly and were trading at quite daunting valuations before the derating started happening. So almost all the positives had gotten priced in. Now post demonetization, everyone will have to moderate in their models the expected growth over the next couple of years. And I think that along with the fact that there was some profit booking because all the portfolios were overweight in NBFCs also has led to this fall. I would hold out and look at each individual NBFC's commentary, management commentary after the December quarter numbers before venturing into and buying any of these. Unless I think the fall is savage in some of them from now till the results and sort of, you know, that valuations become very attractive. But in general, I would still sort of, you know, be very cautious because pockets of growth like LAP, lab business, especially where the underlying has been business income, which has clearly gotten impacted, I think will have impact on the results. Rural-focused NBFCs, you know, where disbursements and collections are both in cash, clearly have got impacted. So I think the derating is here to stay for some time. Let's wait for the commentary after December rather than rushing through. So I would say in case of NBFCs, the phrase, make haste slowly.
What do you do with something like a Reliance Industries? You know, it's trading at attractive valuations. Still, the demonetization of before that, when it went to 1200 around the Jio launch, there was a lot of buzz as to what happens over there. Do you like that name?
I think we are constructive on Reliance Industries. We would still await, I think, you know, how the Reliance Jio pans out over the next half year or so before sort of, you know, taking a final call. So I think, you know, we are constructive, but I think we are still in a watchful mood in case of Reliance.
Right. In terms of real estate, what will be your view? Do you think real estate is, one space where valuations are good or market is extremely pessimistic? So any positive news flow and the sector can do well?
Yeah. See, in case of real estate, I think this is one of the sectors which post-demonetization was expected to get impacted the most. Although, let's not gainsay the fact that the demand, latent demand for affordable real estate still continues to be very strong. So I think I would sort of, look at those names in real estate, I think, which basically cater to the affordable housing demand and have lesser of their exposure to some of the higher end markets. But I'll still sort of be cautious there. I'll wait for the results and then take a call.
Right. Ajay, thank you so much for taking our time for us. That is a view coming in from Prabhudas Lilladher on the markets and the stocks that one should be focusing on.